Well, good afternoon, everyone. Today I'll be talking about storytelling in a new media environment and strategies that I've used to tell stories that matter. I guess I'll try to be heard this time. So, my name is Mohini, and I wear many hats. I'm a designer. I work with games, experience, and narrative to tell better stories. I also run Antidote, a play-focused, platform-agnostic design studio with my partner, Ben Norskove, who's here in the audience, where we use games to visualize human agency in complex systems like climate change, but more about that later. As an artist, I use games and play to engage with topics that are hard to understand, like social inequality, colonialism, and the changing role of women globally. Games allow my players and me to talk about problems without using words, and I call this process play-centric design. But again, more about that later. First, let's talk about stories, and why do they matter? I grew up on a cargo ship, and I was the only kid on board, and the world of adults was confusing, to say the least. Stories were my only refuge. They normalized my situation, since all the books I read were about adventuring children in odd and child-inappropriate spaces. Our ancestors told stories to understand their environment. Gods created thunder and lightning. It made sense to them. Today's storytelling is a one-size-fits-all term for everything from UX to advertising to roller coaster design. The magic of stories is in that something that speaks to us, allows us to have a subjective moment of convergence with something bigger than us, something that can be for everyone and for just one person at the same time. Imagine what power that gives storytellers. New forms of media have allowed for multimodal narratives to exist, symbiotically feeding into each other to sustain vast and complex worlds of stories across books, films, games, memes, VR, etc., etc. These new forms of media are playful, lighthearted, and appear to be trivial. If we try and compare them to traditional media like books, but these new media forms pack different punches, affecting their audiences in new and different ways. The big difference here is that the lines are blurred between who tells the story and who consumes it. Who indeed, right? Since the old distinctions between storyteller and audience are falling aside, more of us are storytellers, whether we know it or not. Journalist Laurie Penny writes about Stephen Moffat and Mark Gratiss's Sherlock as fan fiction with high production values, leveling the hierarchy between the official storyteller and the casual storyteller in a much-beloved franchise. Stories are how humans have made sense of the world. Who did what to whom and why? We have used them to explain ideas as disparate as climate, illness, faith, fear, hate, love, etc. What is the world around the story, though? I call it the narrative because it is the story of the story, in a sense. What happens to a story after it is let loose in the world? Does it disappear? Does it get reimagined? Does it inspire new stories? The impact of the story remains subjectively affective, at least from the point of view of the original storytellers. Some storytellers embrace this narrative, this world that emerges around their story, but most benignly ignore it. Well, unless marketing is involved, right? Minutes after a trailer is released, Tumblr is full of speculations and theories about what it will be about. Perhaps this has always existed, but we can observe this creation of narrative, a narrative universe almost, in real time now. Pokemon Go released just the images of its team leaders a few weeks after the game had made a huge impact in the world. This led to rich backstories and alt lives of these characters being created by fans in minutes. In this case, the story was the picture and the names of the team leaders. The narrative was the manner in which we interpreted them. The we in this case being our collective unconscious, i.e. Tumblr. If stories are authored, narratives are emergent. This narrative of a story is contingent on sharing, on inviting others to reinterpret them. Narratives are emerging, but stricter rules around copyright and content mean mashups and fanfiction will get regulated more and more. In this time of multi-channel, multi-modal storytelling, why is the focus on maintaining authorship? The original is getting less and less important as a value proposition to the people who consume and participate in these narratives. Let us consider the value of a pumpkin. Well, clearly, this picture of a pumpkin is not the real pumpkin. Is this pumpkin a lie? It isn't, not really. It has a different form of value. At this point, the image has lost all connections to reality. But I say, so what? While the simulation is a copy of the real, the simulacra is a copy of the copy. Now, the simulacra has completely different values from the original, and it owns its form. It owns its politics. By constructing and controlling a system of values around the simulacra is, in a sense, a new original. If the original story is the pumpkin, the narrative around it is the pumpkin spice latte. By constructing and controlling a system of values around the simulacra, the simulacra is, in a sense, a new original. If the original story is the pumpkin, the narrative around it is the, let's just move on. What do we value in this narrative universe around our stories? Do we value the potential of storytelling, or do we value the in-canon value of these emergent narratives? Well, let's talk about realness and how, that didn't work. that's supposed to be a GIF. Let me see. There we go. Ah! All the presentation issues. There we go. I'm just gonna give up. Okay. So this slide was supposed to be money that you put on a screen and it becomes screen money. So imagine that's happening as I say this. Let's talk about realness and how realness guides a lot of our media creation, right? The conversation around rendering the most real stories gatekeeps certain people from being able to construct in-canon narratives. Old school video games were unable to achieve realism that is sought after today because the technology couldn't support it at the time. But they went down a path of providing physical objects and building narrative terrariums, if not a narrative universe, to give players ownership and the ability to interpret their stories in their own ways. Modern video games are obsessed with being hyper-realistic, to the point where rendering the most realist textures takes over representing any sort of lived reality. One reason for this is that these modern technologically augmented stories are being created by very few people, but more on that later. As a designer, constraints are a key facet of meaningful creative output for me. Here, let's take an aside and consider what Klaus Fisch is speaking about. The fog of war, a feeling of confusion that leads to a lot of crucial decisions being made in the battlefield. We are in a similar fog, but of technology here. When we're unconstrained, are we truly free, or are we prisoners of choice? While we're consumed by the shiny new tech, are we deprioritizing their potential? Since we're reacting to the technology and not being mindful about how we use it, we end up focusing more on the realistic visual renderings of landscapes and characters in war games instead of modeling character behavior or thinking about the abusive relationships we're allowing to exist in virtuality. Technology is the focus of our story, so it's not surprising that our stories are almost tech demos. Let's see if this works. Ah! It does get frustrating sometimes. Anyway, my GIFs are a failure, I give up. I'm new to Keynote, I just don't know how to make it work. Control defines our relationship to technology. Even if we talk about choice, we're really just building systems to contain the player's choices so we can guide and control the story. Dividing up the player's time into small specific interactions is a form of control. While new media and technology are positioned as mediums of choice for players, they're defined more and more by control instead of this choice. Controlling the player is a way of controlling our stories because we are still telling stories in a linear form while our medium is multimodal. Why should we care about the narratives around our stories when we have no hope of controlling or monetizing them? The text or the story might be finite, but the system of narrative is truly infinite. How can we harness its potential? Can we give up control? Can we share authorship with our audience? It's a tough question, and the best we can do is try different strategies of sharing. Bach is speaking about writing specifically here, but his ideas scale well to our current concerns, storytelling at large. At Antidote, which is the studio I run, we use playful experiences to understand complex realities. What that means is we use games and play to visualize complex networks for humans with humans. We use a process called player-centric design to co-design a problem space with the main stakeholders and together try to play through these problems to better understand them. It's a good question. Why player-centric? Because players are individuals with agency. In games, we build worlds for players, but these worlds carry forward our subjective values. Since we work with real-world systems, we wanted to rephrase the relationship that nonprofits have with people they want to help. Instead of receivers of aid, we wanted to rephrase that relationship around agency or the lack thereof that stakeholders have. By co-creating the problem space, the players can channel their own lived reality to model the systems, focusing on the issues that matter to them. When we build solutions without input from the core stakeholders, we use our value system instead of theirs. The image here is from the first workshop from a three-year project where we had no plans of co-designing anything. We took a suite of games produced for different African countries that spoke about climate change, which was what we were here for, to build games about climate change for Indonesians. To cut a long story short, two out of the three games we presented had gambling as a primary mechanic, something that's perceived as fun and enjoyable in a lot of places. Indonesia, though, turned out to be an exception. It is only the largest Muslim country in the world, And gambling is seen as a sin in Islam, something that our audience of non-traditionally educated farmers were understandably sensitive to. Our projects were so client-focused, that is, the concerns of the nonprofit, not the final players, that we just forgot to consider this. It is important to remember that while we are all learning how to use these newer mediums of communication, that we will make mistakes. What matters is not that we made a mistake, but how we respond to being told we are wrong. This workshop had an incredibly, it failed incredibly. Like, people came, they had fun until we started playing with dice, and that was not fun at all to them. It was something that was really confusing to us because dice are generally viewed as a fun, pleasurable activity. Rolling dice, that is. But that wasn't the case here. Moving on. To accurately model the system, we have to design with the players included in the process. This is essential when a project has a presence in the real world. These are some pictures from a co-design workshop in the Philippines after the first one in Indonesia, where we learned a lot about how to design conversations. I was there to make a game explaining climate change to non-traditionally educated villagers again. A lot of our work does involve non-traditionally educated folks, and we have to be respectful of their position. My initial focus was based on my clients' feedback about explaining the science of climate change in a fun, playful way. However, the workshop revealed that what was important to them was how farmers are impacted by the system, not the system in itself. The Suta games that came out of this workshop were small mini games that spoke about different moments where farmers feel helpless because their agency, and through that, their impact on the system is never clearly communicated. The students you see here attend Shanti Bhavan, a special school where at-risk children are given the same resources that private school students get in India. I was visiting the school and we decided to do an impromptu game design workshop with no resources other than a few chessboards and this carom board, and an assortment of random bits and bobs. This group of sixth graders built versions of chess talking about sexism, a carom game to model isolation. All of this was made just by them. I just took the pictures. This is an image from Officers of Otago, a game we designed to talk to district-level ministers about resilient long-term developments. It was a particularly tough topic as district-level ministers have a short term of 5 years in office in Uganda, where the game was designed for. We modeled the game around an economy of reputation that visualized the minister's impact over 20 years instead of their term of 5, to show how smaller, less sexy, so to speak, developments, like schools and hospitals, can often have a higher impact over time on your constituents and on your own reputation than, say, a flashy football stadium. The game allowed the ministers to contextualize their choices over a long scale of time and allowed for softer changes to happen. We try to keep Bernie's words in mind when we design anything. Play can draw the worst in people too sometimes, but we can all agree that might not be the best path for you. We design terrains for meaning to emerge, but the players decide what this means to them. Play is subversive. It allows us to shape new relationships to the world around us. Play with your content. Take a page from game design. Build a terrain from which meaning can emerge, instead of focusing too much about the message. Why don't more people care about issues like climate change? I can't think about a topic that impacts every human on this planet. But still, by playing through these systems, you can observe why this issue happens. What is the break that happens between such a large topic and the people who are most impacted by them? Remember the co-design workshop from Indonesia? We realized that our initial assumptions about the needs of the community that we were providing aid to was wrong. If we had gone ahead with the project as is, we would have wasted an incredible opportunity to reach stakeholders. By accepting our limitations and learning from and with our stakeholders, we can create more robust, long-term solutions that give them ownership, which then encourages these projects to grow and evolve as per the needs of the community. Only time will tell how well the solution scales, but we've been using this process for several years now, and accepting that we can be wrong has allowed us to tell better stories. Thank you.